Respect is the foundation of all human relationships. The term respect has the meaning of giving the other a certain degree of reverence, and it is desired for itself and for its associated values. Respect is one of the most important human values, especially in social interaction. Respect prevents a person from having reprehensible attitudes towards others. Many religions approach the issue of respect for others because mutual respect is one of the most simple and essential conditions for healthy living. Dialogue with personal interaction and the ability to listen is also very important in all kinds of relationships. In all situations, dialogue is the best way. In a pluralistic country like the Holy Land, is it possible to have dialogue? Is it possible to live together and to work together for peace and justice?
Welcome to our other appointment of Insight of the Holy Land. Today I have got an honor and a pleasure to present to you Professor Mohammed Dajani, a very famous family for centuries in the Holy Land. Thank you, Professor, for joining us.
Thank you for inviting me. It's a pleasure to be here.
Professor, before we go into the extraordinary activities and your programs, present programs, could you tell us a little bit of this famous clan, Dajani clan, which is present in the Holy Land for centuries? In 1529, I think, you're already present here, even before. Could you share us a few words?
Yeah, sure. Actually, my great-great-grandfather, whose tomb is actually outside your office here in Memella, graveyard, he came to Jerusalem back in the 15th century. And he was a Sufist, and he became so well known for the works that he's doing and charity and volunteerism and all the good work that he did, that Sultan Suleiman appointed him and his family to be the custodians of the King David tomb. And it has been in our family since then, till 1948. When the whole Mount Zion fell into no man's land. And then in 1967, the Israelis took over the area. Within the King David tomb, it is a shrine that is revered by the three religions, Christians, Muslims, and Jews. There are two mosques there. There is the tomb of King David, and there is also a hall where Jesus had the Last Supper. And that's why it is important. The site is important for Jews, Muslims, and Christians.
And I know that in the past, certainly also in the present, there were many prominent figures, ministers of tourism, if I'm not mistaken, judges, artists. Just some of them.
Actually, we have the first mayor of Jerusalem, which was the second city that will get a municipality after Istanbul in 1863, was Abdurrahman Dajani. And then Arif Dajani became also a mayor for Jerusalem between 1908 and 1922. We have also judges. We have the first hospital was built by Dajani. A private hospital was built by Dajani, Fuad Dajani.
Still functioning.
Yes, in Jaffa. And Subh Dajani, actually, he was blind, and he wrote the Holy Quran in Braille. for the blind.
For the first time, if I'm not mistaken, in the world, not only in the Holy Land.
Yes. And there were many judges, mayors, lawyers. Actually, in 1938, Hassan Sultan Dajani, who was a lawyer from Cambridge, and he was here, he was working in Palestine for interfaith and cooperation between Muslims, Jews, and Christians, was assassinated by radicals for his moderation and for his reconciliation efforts.
So in a way, you really gain a lot of knowledge, experience. Then you return in 93?
Yeah.
How was your return? What was your place in the society and with politics? Did you play a role? Did you collaborate with the government, with present president, but also with the previous?
Yeah, actually, when my father finally got me a family reunion permit to come back in 1993. But for 2 years, I was in Jordan, and then I came back in 1995, where I worked as chief technical advisor for the UNDP, the United Nations Development Program, in order to develop the public administration sector of the Palestinian Authority. And in this, I was in charge of the hierarchical structure of the various ministries. And then I established the Palestinian Public Administration Institute in order to train Palestinian civil servants, where we actually, for 2 years, we trained thousands of people in management, in administration, in how to deal with the people, in all aspects that deals with government.
Now we get to a very important topic. Your activity of today, Wasatia Center. Please, can you share with us how did it start? It was a particular moment in your life, and it's worthwhile to mention it today, I think.
Yeah, actually, Wasatia, when I was in Jordan, I lived in Jordan for 10 years, and I always was impressed by the views of His Highness Prince Hassan. And one of the things that Prince Hassan promoted in the 70s and 80s was the concept of wasatiyya, moderation, in Islam, and interfaith dialogue. So back in 2006, in late 2006, it was Ramadan, and Hamas has been elected in January to be to have the majority in the seats in the Legislative Council. But when Hamas was elected, we thought that it will bring a new breath into Palestinian politics. And it will reform things, because they ran on the slogan change, reform, and integrity. And so we thought that with change and reform, we will have better government. Also that it will not be a one-party system, but rather a multi-party system. However, we were disappointed because once they got elected, instead of using the national agenda, which is peace and reconciliation, they focused on their own agenda, which is no recognition, no peace, no dialogue, no armed struggle, and things like that. And so we got disappointed with the shift of terms. And it was late 2006, and I was standing on the balcony of my house, which was overlooking the Israeli checkpoint in Beit Hanina, Dahat al-Barid, that area. And there were more than 500, 800 Palestinians gathering in front of the checkpoint, wanting, because it was Ramadan, it was a Friday morning, and they wanted to go to Al-Aqsa to pray. And the Israeli police and the army was pushing them back because they did not have permits. And so there was a clash between them, and the Israeli army was throwing at them tear gas to push them back. and the Palestinians were insisting not to budge. And I was looking at that situation and thinking that there will be killing and there will be martyrs and there will be shooting and it will be a big media event, tragedy. Mm-hmm. And however, I noticed after a while that things cooled down, and it seems that there was a deal struck between the officer at the checkpoint and the people, in which the officer brought buses, and then he had the people take, he took the IDs from the people, and then the buses took the people to Al-Aqsa to pray, and then the buses brought them back. They got their IDs and went home. And every Friday they did that. So I was looking at what happened, and I thought, those are Muslims, those are moderates. The question is, they don't belong to the extremist groups who would not have accepted the Israeli deal. But this was a win-win situation. The Palestinians got what they wanted, which is to pray. The Israelis got what they wanted, which was security. And in this way, it was a win-win situation. My question was, these people are moderates, Muslim moderates, who represents them? There are no party in Palestine or group or initiative or movement to represent them. So in January 2007, I started the Wasatia movement. And then I called for, on March 21st, called for the first annual conference that used to take place every year.
Right, now we will have a look at the center, which we visited with our cameras.
So here what we are doing in Wasatia, we are doing about trying to build a moderate society within the Palestinian society community. We try this in different aspects. We started as courses. We give courses for like creative thinking courses for teachers, for students, for schools, for communities in the Palestinian community to talk about moderation and how they can be a moderate person in their community and their lives. And we also give creative thinking courses. We gave them at universities, like some Palestinian universities, and we gave courses for high-level courses for the students at the university for master degrees, and we gave courses for teachers in schools, and we also gave it for schools students. And this is the first part of our work. It's like how to teach people creative thinking, modernization in the community, and how we don't try to change people, we just show them another aspect of life. In the other words, well, the other thing that we do, we are trying to build a moderate community that believe in modernization. So we believe that moderacy is the way and not violence. We're against violence, like to achieve your aspect, but the people don't understand what is a nonviolent movement or what is centralized. So we are now, we are in the phase of promoting reconciliation in the Palestinian society. So now our aspect is to teach them reconciliation. Not to teach them actually, as to promote reconciliation for the Palestinian people. So we're doing this through our social digital media. We are still developing it. We finished the developing phase. Now we're gonna try to put inside our site more information about the community of Wasatia. It's to create a community in the Palestinian people that believe in reconciliation and believe in centralism, modernity, and of building the society. Wasatia.info, okay. You will see it's two websites, not just one website. Okay. The first website is for about Wasatia and the Wasatia work.
Okay.
The second website, if you go to community, you will find social digital network. It's like Facebook,
okay.
Exactly like Facebook, but it's not Facebook, and it's for reconciliation.
So
we are adding people into the site who believe in reconciliation, whether Israelis, Europeans, internationals, Palestinians. First, you have to have people that believe in peace. Before they believe in peace, they have to believe in peace in themselves. This is where reconciliation comes. We are into communities building and community society to try to build the awareness and promote what they are feeling.
This is Wasatia.
Yes.
This is exactly like, I felt like listening to this like a fresh air. into this environment, into this situation of today, and one would like to breathe it all the time. And we hope it will be the time when there will be only this kind of air. Could you tell us a little bit about this tragedy? We already had a few words. You are working mainly with Muslim, with youth. I believe you aim at the youth, but not only, also at the leaders.
Actually, we work with Muslims and with Christians and Jews also, because initially the focus was on moderation in Islam. And then we realized, but there is moderation also in Christianity and Judaism and Buddhism and all other religions. And so that's why we moved from another level, from moderation in Islam to moderation and religions. And then we found out that, well, moderation is a human aspect. Even Socrates talked about moderation, Plato, Aristotle, all the philosophers. So we are talking now also about moderation in human as a human value.
And the name precisely, Wasatia, explain us.
Wasatia is a word that means in Arabic two things. Well, many things actually, but the four main things is that it means center. And it's like center of the table or center of middle of the room. And then it means also tolerance, acceptance, justice. In the Quran, there is a verse, which is verse 143, and Al-Baqarah Surah. And Al-Baqarah Surah is 286 verses. So 143 comes exactly in the middle. The preceding verse, 142, says, God will guide you to the right path. And then verse 143 says, and thus we have created you a moderate, a temperate nation. And so, وَكَذَلِكْ جَعَلْنَاكُمْ أُمَّةً وَسَطًا. So we thought we will take that verse from the Quran and actually try to promote it as our motto for Wasatiya. But there are also many verses in the Quran that calls for moderation, even in the way we live, in the way we eat, in the way we dress, in the way we deal with others, whether they are Muslims or Christians, Jews, or even kafirs, and how we deal with them, and to use dialogue, because it says, وَجَادِلْهُمْ بِالَّتِي هِيَ أَحْسَنُ, and argue with them nicely or softly or in that which is best. Also, we focus in our workshops on explaining to Palestinians a lot of the Quran, which they do not know from others, from radical Islam, because there are radicals who are misinterpreting the Quran to claim
which
that...
Which happens with many holy books.
Yeah, yeah. Which they want to claim that there is a clash between Islam on the one side and Christianity and Judaism on the other, while actually it is totally the contrary, where Islam is a continuation of Christianity, Judaism, and so Islam has the same values. But what is different is how people interpret things. It is what God made are similar in values, what man made are the differences in values.
Could you share us about one of the events which brought about so many controversies and appreciated by some and admired by some and criticized, and even somehow you were punished for this courageous step of bringing Muslim students to Yad Vashem?
Yeah, actually, I always was fascinated by man and his nature and why will man do things. And then when I came to the issue of the Holocaust, to us it is a taboo topic, so I never learned much about it, and it remained in the background because we believed either it is propaganda to rationalize taking over Palestine, or it is exaggerated, or it didn't happen. And in November, in February 2011, I was invited by a French organization called Alaeddin, where they invited more than 200 religious leaders and academics and politicians to come to Auschwitz to visit Christians and Muslims mainly. And so I went and I saw. And then one of the things that hung on my mind, that one should not be a bystander. And then I wrote an article with a friend of mine, Dr. Robert Satloff, in which it was published in the New York Times, where it said, why should Palestinians learn about the Holocaust? And then Palestinians criticized it, saying, why didn't you write an article saying why the Israelis should learn about the Nakba, or the Jews should learn about the Nakba? And then I had a chance, opportunity, with the German professors to actually develop, and Israeli professors, to develop a project in which we wanted to study the impact of empathy on reconciliation. So the program
was empathy, not just for one side, as you.
Yeah, the idea was exactly.
Yes.
The idea was to take 30 Israeli students to visit a Palestinian refugee camp and talk to Palestinian refugees from the 1948 Nakba. At the same time, to take 30 Palestinian students to Krakow and Auschwitz to visit Nazi concentration camps and see the impact of the suffering of the other on their feeling for empathy for the other. And how will this empathy create a reconciliation?
Why did it have extreme reactions, do you think? Especially among Palestinians, why such a negative reaction? Yeah. Because you didn't invite only to look into the one side suffering, but both.
The problem was, first, the general environment was the collapse of the negotiation, one thing.
Okay, the time.
That's the general. The second was that when we were in Auschwitz, we stayed 2 days in Krakow and 3 days in Auschwitz. And on the second day in Auschwitz, the Israeli Haaretz newspaper translated, wrote about the trip. But when the Arabic newspapers translated about that article, they said it was funded by Jewish organizations, two Jewish organizations.
Okay. So it was just a misunderstanding, misinterpretation.
I don't know if it's a misunderstanding or it was intended misunderstanding, misinterpretation.
Misinterpretation.
Because they said that although the original article said this was funded by German research foundation, and it was with the German also university, Jena, Friedrich Schiller University at Jena, in addition to Tel Aviv University and Ben-Gurion University, but they focus only on the Israeli universities.
Professor, I'm sorry, we would love to really continue this, but we also know that there is your website where we can find a lot of information. You know, my first impression when I met you, and it's still lasting, this incredible peace and serenity and you know, in a situation like this, we all worry and we all lose patience. This is the first. You are patient, you are courageous, you don't fear, and you believe. Where does it come from?
I think it comes from my faith in man, because I believe in man, I believe in humanity, and I believe that our children, as other children, should live in prosperity and should have the chance and opportunities as other peoples do have. And, and this belief in humanity gives me the strength that I should continue to persist despite the odds. On the contrary, that more energy should be put into when there is a crisis, you put more energy in swimming against the tide than you swim
with the current. Exactly. A word which you would like to remember our viewers when they think about Professor Dajani, a thought, a final thought.
Optimism.
Optimism. Fantastic.
Remain optimistic.
Fantastic. This is wonderful.
And have faith in God and in man.
That's what we need. And we thank you, Professor Dajani, for joining us in this interview.
Thank you very much for
dedicating your time. And we are really with you in promoting and giving to our interviews, to our viewers, the optimism and the hope, because that's what there is in the Holy Lands. And we experience it with people like Professor Dajani. And we invite you to our next appointment with another guest, which will join our program. Thank you very much from Jerusalem.